Well, good morning, Harvest. How are you? Glad you're here today. We have a chance as a church to walk through the book of Colossians. And I love one of the pillars that we have. I love all of our pillars, but one of the pillars really sticks out to me right now because of this passage that we're in. And it's proclaiming the authority of what? Oh, I'll have to try again. It's proclaiming the authority of what? God's word. Proclaiming the authority of God's word. I love the fact that as a church, we take time and pour ourselves into a book of the Bible through the chapters of that book and into the verses of that book. And I love everything about that because it helps us understand the purpose and the intent of the book. It helps us understand the context of the book. It helps us have a great understanding and appreciation for what the Lord is doing, and it's for us today. Now, last week, Pastor Dave opened up Colossians chapter 3, and we got through verses 1 through 4. And what a great word for us that we as a church have the opportunity to set our hearts on things above, to set our mind on things above. That's where we landed the plane last week. How are we going to be as a church putting our focus, putting our heart and our intent into the Lord and leaning into what He has for us? He wants us to focus on Him. Now, there was something I didn't like about Pastor Dave's message last week. I don't know if you thought this, but for me, I'm like, when he put that guy up on the screen with a football in his hand, I'm like, come on. Remember that? Like, come on. He can't do that. We've got to stop that stuff. But that's all right. We're going to look at this passage here and see what it has for us. And so I would love for all of us to stand together. I would love for us to take a look at this passage. And let's read it. The respect we have for the word here. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming. In these you once walked when you were living in them, but now you must put them all away: anger and wrath and malice and slander, obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed by knowledge after the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and in all. Let's say that together. Christ is all and in all. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this passage. It's a heavy one. It's got a lot to say. We want to be a people who are taking your word and seeing the challenge of it, connecting with it, committing to it. We're asking for you to give us the strength as we walk through this passage that we would find our hearts in a place of obedience and willingness to do what you ask us to do. Father, give us hope in these days ahead. We know the struggles are real, but we are committing our day to you, our time to you in this passage. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. You know, this past week, one of the things that I love to do is meet with different small group leaders and interact with them and find out how is God showing up in your life and what is God teaching you. And so this week I sat down with a couple guys and we were just interacting about some of the passages of Scripture, and it took about that long for them to come up with, here's what I read this week. Here's what the Lord has encouraged me with this week. Here's where the Lord has pressed into me this week. Here's some of the things that I learned and received and heard and seen, and I love the Lord. And I'm like, I'm so grateful for our leadership and for us as a church, a people who are committed to getting into the Word and to fill our minds and to fill our hearts with the things that are true and our right, and the Scripture breathing into our life. That is so healthy. And as I think about this passage here, I thought, well, honesty in church today. Who's in favor of honesty in church today, everybody? So let me ask you this question. How many of you have a certain sin? How many of you have maybe a couple sins that are easy to see them creep back into your life? You can see these sins and you're like, ah. How many of you have that? Could you raise your hand to be honest? Keep your hands up. Now look around. Look how many people that is. Now you can put your hands down. That's not an encouragement that we all struggle with sin, but that is an acknowledgement that Satan is alive and Satan is trying to penetrate who we are, and he is trying to get a place in us that is not rightfully his. And the thing that you should be encouraged by is that you are in a church today that we can encourage one another in these things. Hey, I'm going to come alongside of you in this difficult time. I'm going to come alongside you in this trial. I'm going to come alongside you in the midst of this temptation. I am going to be there with you. I want to be your accountability. I want to point you to the scripture. I want to be the one who helps you set your heart and set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. We can do that together. Yes, we can see how these things can creep in. And this passage here, as he just got through telling people to set their hearts and minds, hey, watch out, because there's going to be some things that we have to put off in our life. So you ready for it? Got your seatbelt on? Buckle it tight, because it's a tough list. And we're going to see what God has for us. But the first thing I think of here is verse 5. It says, put to death sins of the flesh. That's not who you are. How to live a renewed life? We have to put to death the sins of the flesh. That's not who you are. That's a pretty aggressive statement. Put to death? Wow, that seems pretty violent, but it really means this. Don't play with, don't believe you can control, don't believe that you can manage this sin. Don't believe that you'll get away with this sin. Don't believe that the effects won't spread. Call the sharpshooter and take the kill shot. Put it to death. These are serious. And Paul wants to get their attention. You just got through setting your hearts and minds, but watch out. This Satan is going to try to sneak in and creep in and reveal himself again. Get the sharpshooter. Take the shot. Put it to death. That's a tough visual, so I came up with one that's a little more pleasant for you to look at. Take a look at this thing. Oh, man. How many of you know what that is? Know what that is? A scorpion. So I lived in Arizona for about 4 years. Sherry and I were there. And my sister, man, she has been stung by scorpions about 6 times or 7 times. And I'm like, Brenda, what are you doing? Like, call up an exterminator, get out of the house, move, buy a different one. So these scorpions, they kind of get their way in, and then they try to, man, they're just crafty, they're sneaky. And I'm thinking, well, if my sister has been stung that many times and I've just moved here, I better get out and do some research on how they're not going to get in to sting me and sting Sherry. I don't want her stung either. So I'm reading, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to put all, so I got it. I got this powder I put all around her house, and there's a spray, and I'm like, yeah, they're not getting in our place, but it's up there because it did get in our house one day. And we were sitting in the living room, and we were reading together, and all of a sudden she looks down, and a noise came out of her that, not usual, out of her mouth, and like, ah, and I'm like, what's going on? Scorpion! I'm like, scorpion! And I'm looking, and I don't see it because it's kind of blending in. But then I saw it, flip-flop off, bam, bam, bam. I mean, I am beating that scorpion like there is no tomorrow. And I look and it's like, it's dead, bam, bam. And that thing is just like smattered all over everything. That is the intensity that Paul is bringing to this. Can you get it? Call the sharpshooter, get out your flip-flop, beat that thing, put it to death. He is so serious about this because this first section is sexual sins that can creep in and destroy. We have to put it to death. Sexual sins. Sex outside the bonds of marriage is off limits. Got it? Warren Wiersbe said this. No amount of positive talk about health will cure a ruptured appendix. The doctor will have to get negative and take out the appendix. It's not easy to talk about these things. We live in a day where we just want more positive. Give me more, give me more. next week we get to put on, but today we get to focus on the things that can so easily creep in, and we have to be saying, no way, no longer, no how. I am going to put that sin to death. See, Satan never wants to show you the shame of the sexual sin. He never wants to show you the pain after the temporary pleasure. He never wants to show you the consequence. He never wants to show you the difficulty of what that's going to do to you and to your relationship. He only wants you to see some of the satisfaction that is such a short moment of time. He never reveals the whole thing. That's who he is. He is someone who doesn't care about you and me. He is like this next picture up here. He is prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He appears to us as a cub. Oh, let's just invite him in. Look at how cozy and cuddly it could be. And he never shows his teeth. But I want you to know, Paul is so intense about this. He's like, put to death these sins here, because these are the teeth that Satan uses to bite into, to devour. Satan is a creep, and he is trying to creep into our lives, and we have to be no. No more, no longer, no how, not today, not tomorrow. I'm sticking with the Lord. You got it? Seatbelt still buckled? Not leaving? Good. All right. Because he says, here's how these sins creep into our life. First one, sexual immorality. The word is porneia. We get our word pornography. Pornography is creeping into our culture at an unprecedented speed. Pornography is creeping in where it used to be just in a magazine form. Now it creeps into our computers, it creeps into our TV, it creeps into movies, and we can become so desensitized that we don't even sometimes see what it really is. And we get hooked, and we take it in more and more. And it is filthy, it is something that will destroy, it is something that God does not have any hand of favor on. Sexual immorality, it's taking place. We cannot be desensitized to it. We have to understand what John MacArthur said. In the New Testament, however, its meaning broadens even past what we have today to include any form of illicit sex. The Bible strictly forbids any sexual activity outside the marriage bond between a man and a woman. Having the opportunity to be in our newly married's ministry, I've learned some things this year, that the amount of people is not only increasing, but pornography is creeping into women's lives as much, not quite at the same rate, as men. And so this is an epidemic problem that we have to be able to say, I'm going to take the kill shot on this. I'm going to take my flip-flop off and kill this thing. I'm going to put it to death. I am not going to let it rule and reign anymore. I am going to have the funeral for this. I'm going to bury it. I'm going to walk away, and I'm going to make sure this can't be exhumed again. Don't play around. Don't be the fool. That's the intensity that's brought on this. I hope you hear it. I hope we can receive it. And we can say, I need to put that to death if it's creeping in. The second one that he says we need to put to death is impurity. It's filth in our lives, uncleanness. It's going beyond the act to the evil thoughts and intentions of our mind. Out of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the heart flow the springs of life. We have to be a people who are guarding our heart from impurity that can enter in so easy and in so many different ways, because Satan is a creep and he does creepy things to get into us. Passion, lust, sexual desire for something or someone that's not ours or not ours yet. Boy, how easy is it for us to justify? Well, we're just going to move in together before marriage. It'll save us some money. It'll help us to... Don't go there. Passion, lust, sexual desire for something or someone that's not ours. It might seem culturally insensitive, and I'm okay with that. because I think as a church we're committed to the biblical literacy and the biblical imperatives that are for us so that we can represent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We can be the ambassador who says, I know who this Jesus is and what he is trying to teach us. I want to live this, and I want to live this in such a way that he receives the glory. And so our heightened spiritual sensitivity of this is a big deal. None of us would go into the fridge, or maybe some of us would, but if you walked by the fridge in your home and you opened up, we have a double handle fridge, and open up the one handle and you go inside and you're like, whoa. You ever done that before? Maybe just in our house? No. You open up a door and like, ooh, something's not right in there. And you don't close it and walk away. Maybe you do. If I did that, that probably wouldn't end well because it's just Sherry and I in the house. But so you like, woo. And so then you smell something that's wrong. And then what do? You open both doors and you're like, what is this thing? And you take what's rotting, what's spoiling, and you take it out and you get rid of it. Matter of fact, you don't just put it in the garbage can in your kitchen because it's going to stink there. You take it away from your place that you can't smell it anymore because you don't want it to spoil the things inside the fridge that are remaining, and you don't want to smell it inside your house as a remnant of. And so will you commit? Will you understand what Paul is saying? That the severity of this stuff, we have to heighten our spiritual sensitivity so that we can smell it and act immediately to get rid of these things in our life. It is literally putting these things to death. Passion, evil desire, our mind working and wanting something that it cannot have. Covetousness, which is idolatry. The root sin of wanting more than what I have. Wanting more than I have, or what I don't have, and I'll do whatever it takes to get it. It's a pretty serious list that Paul lays out before us, and then he concludes by saying, covetousness, which is idolatry, which is elevating our desires above the desire of God. Who would we be to think that that's a good play? None of us here, not our church, not me, not you. Yet it's so easy for Satan, who prowls around, to creep in, to hide behind a bush, just waiting for him, just waiting for her, just waiting for the moment when they appear weak, and then he prances and pounces and wants to do his work on us. No more. Let's take the kill shot. Let's put these things to death so that they have no longer any victory over us. Let's raise the banner of biblical integrity so high that it is not mistaken. Let's come around each other and partner with one another so that we can encourage and challenge and motivate one another to live lives that the Lord would be really pleased with. So there's a little list I'd like to put up for you to start writing down as fast and furious as you can, because I know you write notes really fast, and this is a long list. But there's 7 ways to protect my purity. And these are written in a form, it's like moral fences. It's something that it's written in a masculine tone. It's something that I have used in our marriage, but Sherry has also used. And so you can take and adapt these things. Where it says he, it could be her. Got it? So I'm just going to go through it, write these down. The first one, I will not be alone with a woman who is not my wife. Just not going to do it. This is one way I can fight off any way that Satan can creep in and try to just trip me up. I'm not going to do that. I will not be alone with a woman. Number 2, I will not have unfiltered access to the internet or the TV. Just not going to do it. You can look at any of my devices and you can see that that is true. And at any time, Sherry can take my phone, or she can go onto the computer or go onto the iPad and see what is going on. I welcome that. And any one of our staff guys at any point in any time can go onto, because I don't want Satan to have any opportunity to creep in to who the Lord is trying to fashion me to be. Number 3, I will not have any unaccounted for time. It's not going to have any idle time. It could be the devil's workshop. He could have a heyday on me. so grateful for community and the emphasis that Harvest has placed on community. A group of guys that I can hang around, and I know that when I can call upon them and when we can just do life together. So thankful. I will not have any unaccounted for time. Number four, I will not engage in ongoing private communication with any, with another woman. Got it? Number five, I will not compliment the appearance of a female. Only limited compliments about their character and their conduct. Man, when you find somebody who is doing something that is right, I so appreciate the way that you are kind to that person. I appreciate the way that you cared for that person. I appreciated the way that you served that person in this way here. There are so many ways that we can find the character traits that we appreciate about that person and bring those to light. Okay, so let's be better about these. Number six, I will not have any female friends that are not first friends of my wife. Number seven, I will speak often and publicly about my affection for my wife when she's present and when she's not present. How often do we speak well of our wife? How often do you speak well of your husband when he's not around? It communicates a ton. And when we are practicing, these are just some of the things that might help you fight off, put to death the things that Satan would love to creep in. These might be some things that are of help to you as we wage war on Satan. Why? Why put all these things to death? Paul tells us, look at verse 6. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming. The wrath of God is coming. Man, Pastor John, when are you going to start telling me some good news? It's coming. It's coming. It's coming next week. But it's actually coming at the end of this message. There is hope that he leaves in this little section here to help us see the value of all this. But he said, the wrath of God is coming. I'm like, man, he's pronouncing this. And I can see, even in our culture, why this is so important for us to understand the full counsel of what the Word has to say about God. Garland did an interview on faith maturity in Christians and discovered that 97% of those who are growing in their faith believe that God is a forgiving God. Oh, that's really good. 96% believe that God is a God of love and carries out that act of love for his people. But 37% believed that God judges, and 19% believe that God would actually punish. And so I think there's a little distorted view of who God is. God is a God of holiness and righteousness. God is a God of purity. And God is a judge. And he will not let the guilty go. He will not be mocked. And he will bring a consequence too. And so it's really important for us as a church to understand who God is. He loves us. He cares for us. He has all the power. He is in control, and he wants to care for us as his children. And he wants us to submit. He wants us to align. He wants us to understand this book in such a way that our hearts and our minds are thinking of things above, and we're embracing them in our life. And part of it is when we do, we are willing to say, I am dead to that. Put to death these things. Why? Look at verse 7. Verse 7 says, because in these you too once walked when you were living in them. These are things that represent what you were before you knew Christ as your Savior. These are patterns and customs that maybe filled your life back then, but you put them to death, and unfortunately you've let them, you didn't walk away, you've let the exhume out of. And so just a reminder, put these things to death. They were what you used to be, but they're not what you are today. And then he goes on to another list here. Look at verse 8. So those were sins, sexual sins that we need to put to death. He begins another list here. Put away sins of the tongue. That's not who we are. Put away sins of the tongue. That's not who we are. Look at verse 8. But now you must put them all away. You must put these all away. That literally means taking off or shedding. Put these things away is taking off or shedding. So parents in the room? No parents in the room. Okay, good. We got some parents in here. So when your kids, maybe when they were little, maybe they are still little, they maybe signed up for sports and they played on a rainy day. And they gave everything they had to that game. And so they're playing soccer. They come home and you're watching them come. They're approaching the house and they have mud all over them. And they still have their spikes on and there's mud hanging off the spikes and there's sweat on their jersey and they're approaching the house and you have a decision to make and you're like, what is happening? Stop! You're not coming in this house like this. No chance, no how. Parents, have you done that? Okay. My mom did, for sure. Like, you come in, it's like, no way, you can't come in a house like that. You have to take those off right here. Because if you don't, the effects of you not taking these off, well, you'll see streaks through the house on the floor. You'll see marks on the wall. For sure you're going to touch a piece of furniture and it's going to stain it. Take it off. Shed these things. Get rid of these things. Put away these sins of the tongue. Okay? That's the imagery that he uses here. And he says, put off, put away anger. Anger's the first one. We're in the process of purity. Next week we get to put on, but today we're putting off anger. It's a deep-seated resentment of the heart. A deep-seated resentment of the heart that comes out of the mouth. How many of you have been a victim of someone's anger? I have. It hurts. You feel it. You got that? You remember that? You're like, oh man, it wasn't even that long ago. And I know what that felt like, and I know what it did to me, and I know the effect that it was starting to have on me, and it wasn't good. The effects of anger on a person, or it can ripple off onto others. The next, he says, anger can go into wrath. Wrath is anger boiling over. How many of you had one of these contraptions in your home growing up? Anybody have one of those? You know what that is? It's a pressure cooker. So I dated myself. I'm 120 years old, and my mom used to have one of these, and hers looked a little different. She, on the top of the pressure cooker, there was like this little round piece of metal. And when it wasn't on the stove, it was underneath in the cabinet. I would like to take the thing out and I would hit it across the floor with my hockey stick, and that didn't really go well for me either. But she had this pressure cooker and she would take it out and she would put it on the stove, and I don't know what it was that she put inside that thing, but all I know is she turned up the gas and this thing started to cook. And then before long, there was this like screaming from the pot. And this little hockey puck would start to dance on top of it, and you would hear this obnoxious noise. And it was like the pressure got so great, it couldn't be contained inside the pot, and it worked its way out. And that's what anger can do. Anger can lead us to wrath. And wrath, what can happen, the consequences on another, is just, it's really hard to watch. And if I could be honest with you, in the past, that was something. My anger got the best of me, and wrath did come out. It was terrible. I know God was not pleased with it. But it creeped in such a way that I let an opponent get me all worked up, and I became angry. And then I acted out on that opponent and on a ref. And the consequence of that, I didn't even see. I just kept responding in a way that was inappropriate, wrong. It was sinful. And I kept going. What I didn't think of at the time and what I didn't see at the time was a mom and a sister who was watching all of this. The effects on the people was one. The effects on others that I wasn't even thinking about is another. You have to know that when the anger of our mouth releases itself in the form of wrath upon others, the consequence is more than what you can see oftentimes. And the effect is deeper and wider and put away, shed these things. God is not honored with. And so let's look and see if any of this has crept into us, that we'd be honest enough to say to the Lord, Lord, help me in these things that I might not represent you in this way here. It is not right. It's a bad representation. It leads to malice, evil from our mouth. It's like something malignant that plans evil and rejoices when the victim fails or falls. Malice. The story's only getting worse. Malice has three friends. The first one is slander, hurtful speech that defames someone's character. Have you found yourself ever doing that? Words that tear down the credibility and the character of somebody. Sometimes to make yourself look better or to make yourself look like the victim. Slander. It's pretty normal in our society today. I turned on the news yesterday. It didn't take long for a slanderous comment to be made on the TV. It doesn't take long for us to turn on social media and see some type of slanderous comments about somebody else. Let's not find ourselves doing these things, because the Lord wants us to shed this from our life. Obscene talk, it can lead to that. Foul, abusive. Something that's so disgusting that after you've been around someone who has a foul and obscene mouth, you feel like, I need to take a shower. Right? Don't let that stuff start to creep into our heart. Don't let this stuff start to creep into our mind. Lying. Proverbs 6, 16 and 17, there's six things that the Lord hates. Seventh is an abomination. Lying is on the list. Do not lie to one another. Knock it off. A half-truth is a whole lie. Shaving the truth is not telling the truth. Manipulating, exaggerating, they're not telling the truth. Just tell the truth. It's representing Jesus, who is truth. We are his ambassadors. We get the chance to represent truth. Let's not let any of these creep in, because it doesn't represent him well. And yet earlier, we all raised our hands, or many of us did, and said, I could see how some sins can easily creep in. And so that's why he's so on this. Get rid of this. Put to death this, so that we might represent him better. But we can see the challenge of the heart. Which trap allures you? Which sin is easy for you to give into? When you take a look at this next image, you see some people in a raft, and they're enjoying time together. And sometimes these sins that creep into our life, we don't even see what's coming around or what's ahead of us, or what could be destruction before us, because we've become desensitized to it. We open the fridge and we don't even smell what's rotten anymore. And so we don't respond correctly. These people should have seen the danger ahead of them, or they've become so callous that they might even think that they can make it over that waterfall. But you and I, both looking at that picture, can see that there's no chance, no way that they're gonna survive. This isn't taking us anywhere good if we don't put these things off. So it's a strong word for us today. But Paul doesn't end there. Take a look at verse 10. And have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge, after the image of its creator. Love the fact that we can have a new self. There's hope. That's what he's trying to say. There's hope. And he's going to give us a list of all these things that we can put on. But make sure we get rid of this stuff first. But there's hope. Take a look at Philippians. It's probably two pages back in your Bible. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Look at verses 12 through 15. Not that I have already obtained this, or I'm already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I may have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind me and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way. Change the way I think and see about life. Changing our way of understanding that we have given our lives to Christ. Christ has saved us from all of this. This doesn't need to be a part of our life because he gives us hope that there's a better way for us to live and to represent him well. Our world says that our identity is found in these ways. Our identity is wrapped up and we can't move on because our past defines us. Or our friends and our family, they define us. Or who employs us and what we do defines us. But this passage is telling us that put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. We are in Christ. Therefore, our image, our identity is all about Jesus. And he clothed us with righteousness. Romans chapter 8 says that we are adopted by God. Romans chapter 8 says that the Spirit dwells within us. Romans chapter 8 reminds us that we are conquerors through him who loved us. That's what we have. That's what we are about. It's in him. And just in case the people of Colossae couldn't catch it, he finishes with this. Not Greek or Jew. Your identity is not in your background or in your ethnicity. Circumcised and uncircumcised, meaning it's not your religious background that gives you your identity. Barbarian or Scythian, meaning your cultural background, it's not your identity. Don't get lost in it. The Scythians were a people who are a terrible people. They probably had a rap sheet a mile long, and yet he said that in Christ erases all of that. You might have the greatest resume in the world, but that doesn't define who you are. Slave or free, meaning it doesn't matter what your socioeconomic status is. Our identity is in Christ. Let's look at those words again, and let's say them together. Christ is all and in all. One more time, ready? Christ is all and in all. How do we live a renewed life? We have to be willing to put to death certain things. We have to be willing to put away certain things, and we have to be willing to put on. Jesus is all we need. Christ is all. Listen, if you want to make a big change, you got to make a big move. You want to make a big change in your life in Christ? Maybe your struggle, you look at it and you say, I seem to give in all the time. I can't get freedom from. I struggle with like you have no idea. You want to make a big change? Make a big move. What captures the heart of God? Our hearts responding in humility. Our hearts responding in obedience. Our hearts responding in a way that he captures our heart. So as our band comes, they are going to lead us in a song of worship. But I want you to hear this. Making a big change requires a big move. Most of us in here acknowledged there's some sins that can easily creep back into our life. The only way that we can rid ourselves of these, some of them they need to kill shot. They just need to be put to death. Some of them need to be put away. We need to shed these sins of the mouth. And we need to be able to put on the righteousness, the holiness. We need to put on the hope of Jesus. I would invite you to join maybe others who would be willing to say, my heart and my posture of humility is coming to the front and simply just taking a knee. Lord, meet me where I'm at. I'm struggling with these things here. Call it out to the Lord. He hears you. He will hear you. He will meet you right where you're at and give you hope. But he's looking for us. You want big change? takes a big move. It takes a broken and contrite spirit to say, Lord, that's where I'm at, and please meet me. And so if that's you, as we all stand to our feet and we sing, make your way to the front. Find yourself just humbly before the Lord. We're not a judging church. We're a church that wants to love and to see victory in your life. So think about it. Maybe that's you today.